everybody. Welcome to tonight's show. I'm James, your host, and do not change the channel because we'll be catching up with the rest of the crew later on, or some of them anyway. Quite a while ago, we went down to do a story on a guy called Movin' Melvin Brown, and it was so inspirational, we decided to do a whole show out of it. Now, after you've watched it tonight, you'll understand. One thing you have to take into mind that that we didn't come prepared with lighting, or we only had one camera, so some bits will be dark and some bits will be need mic and stuff like that. So we're just going to go and see Wayne.
And I'm having the pleasure of actually doing an interview with someone that I regard one of the greatest performance I've ever seen live on stage, and that is Movin' Melvin Brown. Before we get to him, he starred in film, he's done all kinds of music. His stage show is just awesome, and you actually get the feeling when you're watching him perform and doing the actual show that he does and the songs that he does, that you're watching the actual artist perform, and that is a feat in itself and very difficult to do. So please welcome Mr. Movin' Melvin Brown. How you doing?
I'm doing great. How you doing?
Y'all better watch this real close. This is one of the few times he's not moving, so you won't get this if you come to the show. So can you tell us a little bit about your background and what got you started?
Well, actually, I started in church. You know, I was, when I went to church, they said, sing and sing loud. They encourage you to sing and sing.
So you didn't disappoint.
No. Of course, when I came along, you know, everybody danced in the 50s. It was like the thing to do. If you didn't dance, you know, it's like you're not even a person. So everybody danced in the 50s, so that was kind of came along naturally. The singing thing was like, I mean, it was that excitement, you know, so.
Excellent. Now, I mean, talking about your singing, because you have a fantastic voice, and your voice that can vary itself to meet the particular artist that you're doing, which is very difficult, as we said earlier. What were some of your influences?
Oh, heck. I went to school with the Isley Brothers, and of course, I think Jackie Wilson and Ray Charles are probably two of the favorite ones of mine. You know, I mean, they were. Ray Charles is still fantastic today. Of course, Jackie Wilson was Mr. Entertainment, they used to call him back then. I mean, when he come on stage, nobody wanted to follow him.
Because he was just fantastic. I mean, just watching some of his old footage, looking at him in his old footage, a lot of people now can't do what he did.
No. I mean, he was very few people you met then that had the whole thing going for him. You either found the guy that could sing well and didn't dance well, or you found the guy that could dance well and didn't sing well. You know, I mean, but he did it all, and he had the look, the style, the charisma, and everything. He did it all great. Yeah.
Wow. And of course, some of the groups that led us out of the doo-wop era were groups like the Drifters, the Valentinos, and those masters of sound who brought us all in with the crooning sound. A group called the Platters, and they had a big hit back then that says, "I'm the Great Pretender." All along to reach can't conceal. Oh, yes. Oh, no power. Okay. But of course, during this time around 1956-57, it seemed like black artists were coming out of woodwork. I mean, there's people like Wilson Pickett, Little Richard, all these guys seemed like all of a sudden they came out of nowhere. But they didn't come out of nowhere all of a sudden. They were making music for a long time, but they just wouldn't play the music on the radio. But when they started to play that music on the radio, people wanted to see who these people are and where they come from. Now, of course, today, they call James Brown the Godfather of Soul. Now back then, James Brown used to stand in the back and hold the curtain and look at this next guy on the stage and say, you know, I wish I could be like him. Now the guy I'm talking about, he actually died in the hospital a couple of years back, and it showed you the injustice of the system. He didn't even have enough money for his own funeral, but he was a star in his own right back then. And he became a star with a song that says, your love is lifting me higher. His name was Jackie Wilson.
Talking about, you know, your history. I mean, what were some of the great, let's say, R&B music companies that were just getting started in the 50s? They had just started to play black music back then. What was that like?
Well, I look back and I think, wow, you know, it was a great time to be around because, you know, you got to see a lot of this stuff being born, you know. And, you know, people like Otis Redding and James Brown, I mean, they were just beginning. But you didn't realize that you were seeing something so great beginning back then. You just thought, hey, man, we're doing our thing, you know.
Wow, I mean, and if you could just tell the people some of the great artists that you work with, I mean, it's like the who's who of R&B music.
Well, I open shows for like James Brown, Smokey Robinson and the Miracles, Wilson Pickett, you know, B.B. King, Bobby Blue Bland, and of course, also, you know, back then, Little Stevie Wonder, you said, guy.
Yeah, 14 years old.
Yeah, when he started, he was this little guy with this big harmonica, you know. And I remember he came into Cincinnati. I think James Brown and the Isley Brothers and Stevie Wonder were like the headliners. And of course, we were doing our thing. And then, you know, they had a couple other groups. But that was, I mean, it was a great time because everybody who got on stage then, they worked. It wasn't like, you know, you get somebody singing a little bit. They worked. And when they came up, everybody was soaking wet. Yeah.
And I know that's true because just watching you perform out there, I mean, that is just amazing show. I don't even know how you keep yourself in shape to do something like that because we were just sitting there overawed. And I mean, it's just good to be talking to someone. You feel like you're talking to, like, history of the music.
Yeah. Well, that's why I put the show together. You know, I was traveling a lot during my show. And people would come up to me because I tell little stories about, you know, when I went to church and how I used to sneak out of the window and go to the clubs and my mother get that switch out after me.
I know all about that switch. My mom used to make me go pick that one, and I'd be picking the littlest one.
Yeah. If you didn't get a big enough switch, she'd throw it away and get another one and beat you. I mean, that was like torture, though. You know, you have to go get something for somebody to beat you with.
Get that switch so I can beat you down.
Yeah.
And, of course, during the early 50s, you didn't hear black music on the radio so much. In fact, it was in 1955 when they actually started to play black music on the radio. And, of course, that's when I actually saw the second black man I ever saw on television. There was a show that came out of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, called Dick Clark's American Bandstand. Now, Dick Clark was the going thing for that time, and he brought on a guy called Chubby Checker, and he was doing something called the twist. Living in Cincinnati, Ohio was a good place to be during this time because, you see, Cincinnati, Ohio was the first city and the first state when you crossed the Mason-Dixon line. Now, the Mason-Dixon line was a line that separated the North from the South. So during slavery times, you made it into Cincinnati, you was in free country. And of course, but during this time, there was a record label out of Cincinnati called King Records. It was one of the only major record label companies that was signing black artists in the country. So people like James Brown and B.B. King, people like this were moving into Cincinnati, and people like Smokey Robinson and the Miracles back then, and they were coming into Cincinnati to record and do shows. And of course, because I had a local group there, we got to open up the show for them. Now, what a lot of these people didn't realize was that when they signed contracts at the recording companies, they lost all the rights to their music. But there was one guy who wouldn't sign on the dotted line. His name was Lloyd Price, and he became a star in his own right with a song called Personality.
For you, 'cause you got
course, during this time, 1955, you know, rock and roll was in full swing. What we really used to call rhythm and blues had turned into rock and roll for some strange reason. But it was in full swing at this time. And of course, one of those guys that we considered the master of rock and roll back then was a guy called Chuck Berry. And he was doing something called Johnny B. Good.
I hope you're really enjoying the music, and we're going to go to a break, so stay with us for more. Welcome back from the break, everybody. Hope you're really enjoying tonight's show. It is a special show. And remember, if you do want to send Movin' Melvin an email, the email address is coming on the screen. But right now, we're going to go back
to
Wayne.
Can you tell us a little bit? I remember you saying a little bit about your Army experience and how you handled that.
Well, I think I was classified as not military material, you know. Because, you know, when I went into the Army, it was a time of the riots and everything. You know, H-Rap, Brown, Stoker, Coleman, the riots and stuff were going on. Yeah. We actually had riots in the Army. So I didn't have a good time then. And then when it was time for me to get out in 65, you know, around the time that Martin Luther King had got killed and the Kennedys and the Vietnam War was starting, it was time for me to get out. Now, this guy, his name was Sergeant Wilson. He had been giving me a hard time for a long time anyway. And he came to me and says, if you had a family then, you could get out of the Army. It didn't matter if a war started. Yeah. But if you didn't have a family, they could keep you in. But I had a family. So I should have been able to get out easily. But he came to me and says, I know you don't like the Army. I know you want to get out. And he says, but I'm going to see to it that you don't get out. And I said, that's okay because, we'll be going to Vietnam together and I'll have a rifle too. I said, the first guy I'm going to shoot. Then, it's like the next day I got my papers,
Funny that. That's the way to handle a dispute.
And of course, rhythm and blues, or if you want to call it rock and roll, was coming into full swing. But the doo-wop era was also still happening big time. And of course, I had my own singing group at this time. And as I said, we got to open shows for groups like the Isley Brothers, James Brown, Wilson Pickett, Ray Charles, Jackie Wilson, all these people were coming to Cincinnati to do shows at this time. And of course, we had a doo-wop group. Now, do anybody know what doo-wop is? Well, I say doo-wop is when you get maybe two or three guys together and you find a place where you can hear the voices coming back off the wall, and you blend the voices together in harmony so you can hear the harmony coming back. Now, of course, we couldn't afford any instruments or anything like that. So what we would do is make rhythm with our hands and our feet, and we should do something called a ham bone, and it looks something like this. Ha 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 ha. And of course, we just kind of make up songs so we could hear the harmony coming back. And one of those songs we used to do was a song called Every Time, and it sounded something like this.
If you could tell us a little bit about some of your influences musically.
Well, musically, I think probably the people that I really like the most are people like Ray Charles, Sam Cooke, of course, and Jackie Wilson was the man, you know.
Yeah, he was. I mean, what a fantastic dancer and performer overall.
Overall performer, Jackie Wilson had to be the best because, I mean, even James Brown didn't want to follow Jackie Wilson on stage. Nobody wanted to go on stage after Jackie Wilson because he had a whole place going crazy, you know.
It's like Jackie's going on, he's done. Anybody want to go on? No.
Yeah, everybody got on and did that thing before, you know.
And, I mean, just watching your show, I mean, the amount of energy and things that go into that and just being able to remember and go through the years. What I like about you is every single song you do, you start to sound like that particular artist. You take on their character and what they do, and it's almost like going back in time and listening to that artist at that time.
Well, you know, that coming up during that time in the 50s, you know, I became a teenager in the 50s. You know, you just listen to all those people, you know, Temptations, James Brown. So you learn to work, you know, work with that, and you realize you had to do a lot more than just get up and sing.
Now, of course, I was too young to be in the clubs. And my mother would always say to me, she said, "Boy, I don't want you hanging around these nightclubs." But you know, the music was there. I needed to be there. So what I would do is when the lights go out in the house and everybody's supposed to be asleep, I would go out the window and off the roof and I'd go to the nightclub. And of course, I'd get there early before the band started so I could get in their way. And when the band bring their instruments in, I said, "Can I sing a song with you tonight? Please, just let me sing one song. I just want to sing." And they would say, "You ain't even supposed to be in here." I said, "Please, just let me sing one song and I'll leave, okay, okay?" Yeah, we'll see. So I'd be sitting there, and the club owner would come by. He said, "Hey, what are you doing in here?" "I'm with the band." And of course, they were playing some of the best rhythm and blues you ever heard. Now, one of those songs I remember so well they used to play was a song called "I'm a Hog for You, Baby," and it sounded something like this. course, I'd sit there in the club, listen to their rhythm and blues until about 2 o'clock in the morning was time for the club to close. Then I'd go back home and I'd get in the window and I'd get in bed. But you know something, it seemed like no matter how quiet I was, my mother always heard me. And I get up the next morning, she said, where were you last night? I said, I was down at the club. She said, go get me a switch. Now, if you don't know what a switch is a limb off of a tree. And the torture in this is to go get something for somebody to beat you with. So I go out, I look real careful, trying to find something I thought wasn't going to hurt too bad. And I bring it back. Now, what I really hated about this, she'd make me lay across a chair in front of her. And then she hit me one time, and she talked to me for 10 minutes. And I'm like, hey, just beat me and get it over with, you know? But it didn't matter. You know, as soon as the lights went out the next night, and everybody's supposed to be asleep, I go right back to the club again. And of course, during this time, as I says, there were people coming through the club like B.B. King and Bobby Blue Bland. And one guy, I mean, they started calling him the Wicked Mr. Pickett because he used to scream all the time. But he used to come through the club. His name was Wilson Pickett, and he had a song going then called I'm Gonna Wait to the Midnight Hour. There was a young man who came along and did something very unique in black music. He recorded a complete country and western album. Now people were saying, you crazy, they're not going to buy country and western music from a black man. Because black people weren't into country and western music so much back then. But he recorded a complete country and western album. Now one song off that album stayed number one for 26 weeks in a row. That was doing a whole lot back then. Now, of course, they called him a genius back then. He was a genius then, and he's still a genius today. His name is Ray Charles, and one of the songs off that album was called It's Crying Time. Oh, it's crying time again. You're gonna leave me. I can see that far away look in your eyes. I can tell by the way you hold me, darling, that it won't be long before it's crying time. They say absence only makes the heart grow fonder.
Now, can you tell us about here, Cincinnati, Ohio, what the movement was like as far as musically at that time?
Cincinnati was, well, it was still a racial place during this time, but you could, you know, you could do your music. We could get in the white clubs, and they would let us come in and sing. We had to go out the back door, but we still was able. If you wanted to be an entertainer, you had to pursue it. You had to push, you know. Yeah, well, I did, and I pushed.
In the early 50s, from 55 to 59, I guess Chubby Checker did about everything you could do with the twist. I mean, let's twist again, let's do the twist. Now around this time, 1959, there was a young man that came along. He had been touring all over the states with a group called the Soul Stirrer, the gospel group. Now he had a voice of silk. Now he came along and he took Chubby Checker's twist and he did something a little bit different with it. He twisted the night away. His name was Sam Cooke.
Hope you're really enjoying tonight's show. It's going really well. And make sure, yeah, if you do want to get email, Melvin Melvin or Balls and All, take your pick. The email's addresses will be on the screen throughout the show. We're going to go to a break, though, so stay with us. Welcome back from the break, everybody. In case you just tuned in, tonight is a special show. A while ago, we did an interview with a legend, so we're going to go back to Wayne.
Now,
check it out.
What message would you give to some of the young people, say, starting off in this profession, and what message would you want to leave them?
Well, I think it's like those saying, you know, follow your dream. You know, I think when I was, and I do a lot of shows for younger people and elderly people all together. In fact, I'm building a home for the people. But what I always do is I say to them, look, you know, if you like to do it, then that's what you should be doing. You know, whatever you like to do, you should be doing it.
I remember it was like 1963, Mr. Carruth. He was an ex-minister who lived in the house behind us. Now, of course, he was taking care of his wife, who had been sick in bed for about 2 years. So what I would do every evening after school, I'd go back and visit with him and help him out, see if I could go to the store for him and do anything to help him out. Now, of course, he would read stories from the Bible to me, and he'd kind of act them out in animation. And you know, I remember hearing somebody say, when you go to a black church, you get a show for your money, and you don't have to pay a lot for it either. Well, that was true, but now, see, I was raised in a traditionally Methodist church. It was pretty quiet in my church. I mean, everybody go in and sit down, and the minister would come on and say, God is good, thank you. But then I remember my aunt started to take us to church with her. Now, that was a whole different story. Because when we walked in the door, the first time I looked over and I saw drums and guitars and saxophone, I thought, wow, they got a band in here. And when they started playing that music, it felt like everybody in the church would start moving back and forth. It even felt like the building was going back and forth with the music. And the songs seemed like they would last 15 or 20 minutes. And then they finally end the song and somebody yelled, "Hallelujah!" And they start all over again. And of course, after they get everybody settled down and settled in, then the minister would come on. Now, he couldn't just tell you a story. He had to act it out. In fact, if I can get y'all to give me some amens and right on, Reverend, and that's right, I'll show y'all how that was. The lesson today is on responsibility. Now, the good book says that you got to be responsible for you. It doesn't say anything in here about somebody else being responsible for you. It says that you got to be responsible for you. Why don't you say amen? Amen. Now, sometimes, not all the time, sometimes you're going to see the brother down the street doing something that you know ain't right. And you don't want to do what he's doing, why don't you say amen?
Amen.
Now sometimes, not all the time, you're going to see sister so-and-so just walking down the street. And you know she ain't going to do something right, and you don't want to follow. Why don't you say amen?
Amen.
Look at him. Now sometimes, not all the time, sometimes you gotta walk right. Sometimes you gotta talk right. And one day, I said one day, the saint of God go marching in, and I said you, and I said you, and I said you won't be in the number when the saints go riding in. to say amen.
Well, it's what I do. To me, it's fun, and it's part of my mission also. Like I said, you know, I have a project called Change This World Project, where I talk about love, and that's what I do. I think that's my mission, is to love and serve people, and I do it through my show.
I have to show y'all how this works.
We're definitely going to want Melvin to come back. So is there any way that people can get in touch with you? Any email address, website, or what have you?
Well, they can go to my website at www.movinmelvin. That's MOVINMELVIN.com. And we also have another website called www.2201 I Love You Day. So you can find us at either one of those. Yeah. I Love You Day is the website. Yeah.
Beautiful. Well, I'll tell you what, this man puts a lot of love into what he does. He's a great performer, and make sure you guys come down and check it out. Moving Melvin, it's been an absolute pleasure. And believe me, this is the last time you're going to see him sitting down.
Wow, so I'm very excited here tonight. I get the pleasure of singing a duet, one of Bruce and I's favorites, with one of the legends of rock and roll R&B music. Let's give it up for Mr. Moving Melvin Brown.
Thank you.
Mason boutique throughout the land. People wake up to fight every day, cause they just don't believe there can be a better way. There are ministers with scandalous affairs. Too many people say that they just don't care. We're at the verge of defending ourselves to death, because some greedy ones wanna deal better than the rest. There are the blacks and the whites locked in a racial war. Children who are being abused near and far. Drugs on the streets in our neighborhood. Killing all precious minds that could do us good. We got to change this world. Change it if we care. We gotta start with the children, teach them to love everyone they can. But we got to change this world. Change it if we care. We gotta start with the children, teach them to love everyone they can. Raise a better child. If we want a better world, we gotta teach them how to love, and most of all, how to love themselves. Have the children take a look around them and know that everything they see, starting with their thoughts, including you and me, they gotta know you can't hurt anybody without hurting yourself. And if you strive to live in harmony, then love is the very first step. We gotta take a good look at the children and teach them that we care, because this great big world we live in will one day be in their hand. Teach them to love instead of fighting. Agree before there's war, and drugs will make them lose their mind before they are very far. Oh, we got to change this world. Change it if we care. We gotta start with the children, teach them. Love everyone. Don't you know we got to change this world? We gotta do it, dog. We gotta teach the children. We gotta give them love, dog. Don't you know?
Change this world. Change it if we can.
I gotta go, y'all.
We gotta start.
But before I leave,
love everyone they can.
I'd like to leave y'all with a very important message. In order for us to change things, we have to start loving. And that love begins with you. You find that love inside of you and share it with everyone. Then the world becomes a better place. And it's nice to be important, but it's more important to be nice. Be nice to someone, and remember, I love you.
Well, I hope you've all enjoyed tonight's show as much as we've enjoyed putting it together for you. In my own history, I've seen some bands like Dire Straits, AC/DC, James Brown, heaps of them, and we actually got a chance to go there and just see it without filming. And just the electricity the guy puts out, he's a real performer. It was an absolute pleasure to see him, as you've seen from tonight's show. Make sure if you do want to email Moving Melbourne for anything, the email address you've seen through the show, or if you'd like to email Balls and All, Your Sports and Leisure Show, that's us, the email address, yeah, go and check out the new webpage as well. And thank you very much to Pure Image for doing that. It looks great. Well, next week we have a great show. I hope you all enjoyed the long weekend. But the Manjim Up No Mercy Challenge is up. So all you motocross people out there, stay with us. Until then, the name of the show is Balls and All.